What an interesting time in the economy and the stock market right now. The two have never been more separate. They're divorced from reality. The economic situation looks desperate. Small businesses are struggling to survive. Some have reopened with limited ability. Many never will get the chance. Bankruptcies are mounting substantially, arguably to a worse level than during the peak of the financial crisis. But you don't need to worry. The Fed cares very, very deeply about you. Sleep tight, my little sheep. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today, we're going to look at the truth, the information that you came here for. I'm not going to sing you a lullaby. I'm not going to tuck you into bed. You are here to know what's really going on with the economy, with the stock market, with the financial situation that is unfolding before our very eyes. I want to take a look at what's going on with the central banks. I'm going to give you some updates on the balance sheets. I'm going to look at some of the data there. Then I want to cover the economic fundamentals as well, because that is absolutely crucial. I've got a lot of data. Let's begin. Bank of America pulled this data, and you could see the balance sheet as a percentage of the GDP, and it just compares right here in this column, 2019 year end. You could see current, and then 2020 year end forecast. I like to see it as a percentage of the GDP because it gives us an idea of how much they're printing in comparison to the economy. We know how manipulated this statistic is, but it just gives you a good idea. Now, looking at the U.S. Federal Reserve, 2019 year end, before all of the troubles started to add up, you could see right here that they expect by the year end 39%. And if you notice right here that this number is not going to change. Why? Because in the third quarter and the fourth quarter, we're going to have the magic pixie dust, the fairy dust that's going to come and help the economy to grow. Looking at the ECB, you could see that from 39%, 1 year later, they expect it to be 61%. That is huge. Same situation with the Bank of England, going from 25% up to 50%. So it depends, of course, if the GDP has come down, but you have the balance sheets rising as a result. These two will, of course, correspond to each other. But in most cases, the data that I have seen has pointed to this fictional reality that third quarter, we're going to start seeing everything grow, and it's going to be fantastic. Look at the case of Canada here. You could see 2019 year end 5%, but at the end of 2020, 33%. Massive growth in the balance sheet like we have never seen before. Because if you see what occurred back during the financial crisis, Canada wasn't hit as hard, and the Bank of Canada didn't have to do the things that they have done today. They really took a bailout from the Federal Reserve, as we can see that information being outlined before. If you want to actually look at all the details on that specifically, I have a video, Fed bailed out Canada, the money GPS. If you search that, you will find it. But regardless, what we're looking at here is just unbelievable when I see it here as a measure of the GDP. It really gives a new perspective on how much they're printing. Aggregate G6 central bank balance sheet in the trillions of dollars. So let me give you an idea of what we're looking at here. This is $25 trillion at that point, and this is 2007. And you could see the Fed, ECB, BOE, BOJ, the RBA, the BOC, all of the banks here have expanded their balance sheets, and you could see how drastic that has been just over the last few months. Now, they intend on slowing down the pace, apparently, because as the economy grows and gets back to normal, well, of course, they're going to wean off of that. Now, this isn't true. This is not the way that it works. As you could see back in 2018, what happened? They slowly but surely started to bring this down slowly, slowly, at the slowest pace you could ever believe. And that created a crisis like we have never seen before. Fast forward to September of 2019, and my goodness, how bad things became in the financial system. The average person, they have no idea what was going on. But if you were on this channel, and if you were paying close attention elsewhere, you know about the repo crisis. This is when the system broke. I do believe that something bigger is going on than what they're telling us, because just a couple days after this all happened, I believe it was September 17th, 17th, where it really started to get hot and heavy. Just a couple days after that, Powell came out in one of their conferences and so on. He was asked the question, you know, with the repo situation, what's going on there? Threw a softball at him. And he said, no problems. We got it under control. It's just going to be a few more days. And then we saw it extending into October. And the balance sheet, meanwhile, is just expanding and expanding and expanding. And they're saying, don't worry, everything's fine. It's just a technical change here. No expansion of the balance sheet. We're not printing money. It's just a technical change. And meanwhile, the balance sheet is just growing and growing and growing. Hundreds of billions of dollars are being added, and they're trying to calm the markets down. It's not working. Even today, the repos are still being done. This is really a problem, and they don't realize that because it is internally. And this was an issue previously, but nothing like we've seen today. This is highlighting the underlying problems in this system. The financial system is rotten from within, and they're trying to print money to make that all go away, but it doesn't work. If you got an alcoholic and then they want to get off of it, so you feed them some alcohol, I just don't see how that works. That is the system of control that they use to control us, and this is why they do it. They add more on top and more on top, because every time they do, they exact their control further. More control, fewer hands. That's the goal, and they've been doing it very successfully. They really took a big leap this time around. All right, take a look at this chart here. Now, I know the font is super small. I'll zoom in, but I just wanted to show you this zoomed out so you could see all of the different countries and what they've been doing. This is Bank of America's fiscal and monetary policy tracker. On the left-hand side, you're seeing the countries. You could see fiscal stimulus, monetary stimulus, and then as a percentage of the GDP, if they've done rate cuts, what's going on with that? And the central bank actions are here, fiscal stimulus actions are there. Everything on one chart. This is fantastic. Doesn't tell me what date it's from, of course, but it is relatively new. So you could see all of this added up on one chart. I'm not going to bore you with all the details. I've been ranting enough in this video already, but just gives you an idea of how extreme. Look at the case of Italy, where it is 53.3% of GDP, the amount of stimulus that they've been putting out there. Why? This is a country that I have been warning about since the euro sovereign debt crisis, the euro viral contagion that I've talked about in numerous videos ever since. I highlighted it specifically in my second book, knowing how deep this problem is. When you see a country like Italy and how interconnected the financial system is with all of the other Eurozone countries, but as well as all the other financial establishments around the world, there is reason to worry. So that is one I am paying attention to very closely. I'll bring you some more info as I can dig it up, but I'll leave you with this. Link will be in the description if you want to check it out. UBS tells rich clients to leave stock bubbles to day traders. It's interesting that they have to actually say this, but of course, the people start to look elsewhere and they think, look, I'm only making 5%, I'm only making 7%, whatever it might be, and these guys over here are making 100% just in the past few months. Something isn't right. So they're demanding more, that puts the pressure on them, but you can see in this Bloomberg article, they highlight some other details saying, don't fall into these bubbles and games. Don't fall into the trap. Try to actually have a structured plan, because when you're dealing with high net worth clients, a lot of times it's more about preserving wealth than it is accumulating. The world's largest wealth manager has a message for any clients tempted to follow day traders into some of the equity market's more exotic stocks in search of a fast buck. Don't even go there. Of course, this is not really sensible for a lot of people, but they see what's going on in the news and they're saying, hey, I want to get in on that action. We're talking about FANG DD. Remember that one? Oh, I want to invest in FANG stocks. They end up buying what looks like FANG, but it has nothing to do with the FANG stocks, as in Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, Google, and so on. When you look at what's going on in the markets, it's crazy because people are buying anything and everything. The stocks that I hadn't heard of 3 months ago are all of a sudden the most active. That That's not where investors go. That's where traders might go or hobbyists might go. If you're a wealthy investor, you have to avoid thinking that you're missing out on huge returns in these stocks. And that's really something that is sound advice. You have professionals who have been doing this for decades and they know how the market moves. They're able not to just to buy in, but they're able to know when to sell. And of course, many people do not win in these cases here because they cannot read the market properly. They think they know, but 99% of the time, they have no idea when to sell. Not so dumb. Small investor stock picks have outperformed mutual fund favorites. So of course, you could see the Goldman Retail Favorites Index, that's the white line, and the blue is Goldman Mutual Fund Favorites Index. Comparing the two, obviously there has been a lot of growth over the last little while, but retail has outperformed recently as the market euphoria, as the panic has really taken hold. Northman Trader had this to say: the global Dow Jones Index, largest liquidity-driven bear market rally since 1929, creating the largest asset bubble inside of the worst global recession in decades. If central banks lose control, history, fundamentals, and technicals suggest new lows are coming. I'm not saying this, but when you look at the technical analysis, it is very interesting. They're showing these patterns here appearing multiple times previously, and the result is always a decline. Now, the thing that's a little bit different here is that the Federal Reserve is applying a historic level of all of their activities. They're doing the QE, the reduced interest rates, but in previous instances, they reduce interest rates too. It's not as if they weren't intervening. Now, the level at which they are, of course, but it remains to be seen how much of an impact printing a bunch of money and buying mortgage-backed securities is really going to have on the markets as a whole. We know that it doesn't fix the economy. We know it doesn't help whatsoever there. It doesn't help Main Street. It doesn't help the average individual. But for the stock market, when you create a bubble like this, it often doesn't end well. The economic situation is what we really need to be focusing on. And this article here, I've already shown you this previously, just wanted to touch on it quickly because it really highlights what's happening. A new report from UK-based economic forecasting firm Oxford Economics estimates that 15% of homeowners will fall behind on their monthly mortgage payments. If that actually does happen, it will exceed what we had seen during the financial crisis. And it looks like that's going to be the case because of how many people this recession has impacted. It has really hit home with so many. I've talked about the statistics numerous times, but the Federal Reserve quoted it themselves. If people are making $40,000 or less, it looked like 40% of these people were laid off. Now that is a shocker. This cannot be fixed by printing money. It simply can't be fixed like this. Here's the data from OpenTable, and I guess you could see this as good news. I don't know, whatever. It's just information. That's what I do here. But regardless, this is giving us an idea of what's happening, at least in the limited view, though it is quite good. Seated diners from online, phone, and walk-in reservations. On the right-hand side, this is May 29th, and here we're looking at June 19th. So you could see as it progresses in this direction, as we move through, year over year, we're seeing the situation getting better at restaurants. Now, it doesn't tell us the whole story. We don't know what's going on, the company's revenue and how many employees they have and how many they laid off and so on. But at least it shows us that the economies are opening up on a global level. If you look at this globally, from May 29th, which it was at approximately 83%, minus 83% year over year, and now it's at minus 61%. That's a big change. In the case of Australia, it was at 88, and now it's at 5. So there, they have really been opening up, it looks like. Canada, in this instance, from 88 to 69. So we've seen some big changes there. The UK, on the other hand, 98% year over year still. So there hasn't been much opening at all, as you can see, at least what we're looking at here. Swiss watchmakers fear job cuts as the crisis hits sales. And this is interesting because we're looking at the luxury market being impacted by this as well. This is an issue here that is affecting so many people, as I've determined and documented all along. But of course, it does have an impact on those who make the least money, who have the least wealth, more so than those at the upper scale. But clearly, when you look at this on a detailed level, everyone is feeling the effects. That's all for this video. If you found it informative, hit that thumbs up button. When you do, you are supporting me. I want to thank you for that. If you just click one button, it will help me out. Thank you very much. If you want to find me on Instagram and Twitter, I've got new information every single day. Definitely check me out at The Money GPS. Do you want to learn how to sell stuff online? You want to understand e-commerce? Well, you don't need to go out there and pay $1,000 for a course. You can do it for free. You can get started right now at theamazongps.com. If you want to understand the financial system, how it works from top to bottom, A to Z, but not have all that jargon, all that garbage that they try to stuff down your throats, well, these two books will explain it all for you in very easy, non-complex ways. Check it out, link in description. If you want the audiobook, themoneygps.com. Wait a second, don't go anywhere. Have you seen this video? It's really important. Got a lot of data in here. Click it. I'll see you there.